Hello everyone and welcome to day two of my advent calendar. Today we will be adding the screen class. Let's jump right into it then, shall we? First of all, we create a class in the same package as previously. We name it screen. And the first thing we're going to do in this class is we're going to add a thread. This thread will need a run method. So what we want to do is we want to implement runnable. And we add the method public void run. So when we create a thread, we can give it the screen object, which basically contains a run method, and the thread knows exactly what method to call when we start our thread. We write private thread, and we name it thread. It's private because we don't want any of the other classes to be able to access it. To initialize the thread, we need our constructor, public screen, without any arguments. In the constructor, we set the thread equal to a new thread. And then we're going to pass in a runnable. Since our screen is runnable, we refer to this as the screen instance. And to start the thread, we need to create a new method. Since this has to be accessed from another class, the frame class, it has to be public. But as the method is specific to the screen class, we don't want it to be static. So let's call it start without any arguments. This method we call thread's start method, so thread.start. So while we're at it, let's create some more methods, which will be used later on. Private void pre-render, which will contain our buffering and actually render our frame later on. Private void render, which is the method we use to call other render methods from different classes. Private void tick is the place where we update the game and call tick methods in other objects. Private void load is where we load everything except the thread initialization, which we need to call the load. Let's work on our run method. This method will contain our game loop, but before our game starts, we want to load our content. So we call our load method. Our game loop should hold track of the amount of frames we update every second, and the amount of updates or ticks we make to our game. These will be tracked individually as FPS, the amount of frames per second, which will not be kept. Our goal is to have as high FPS as possible. The UPS, updates per second, on the other hand, will be capped, meaning our game will never reach above a certain amount of updates per second. So we'll create an integer for frames, set it equal to 0. We'll create an integer for ticks, and set that as well to 0. We'll also need to keep track of time. We do this by creating a double, calling it last second milliseconds, or ms for short, and set it equal to the current time. This method can be found accessing system and current time milliseconds. This will grab the current time in milliseconds, which is also why the name ends in ms. The reason we keep track of this information is so that we know how many frames and updates we've done since the last time we counted. This will also allow us to print out the variables every second if we need to as well. As said, we want to cap the amount of updates we do per second, so let's create a variable. I'll add it to the top of our class. I'll make it public and static so that every class can read the value and do calculations on their own. It will also be final, which means we can't change the value after it has been set. This is used to remove confusion and keep everything organized and simple to read. It will be an integer called target UPS. This is the ideal amount of updates per second. I like to have this value at 60, and though 60 updates per second is not necessary for smooth gameplay, we also want to track the amount of time we're able to spare for each update. So I'm going to create a double and call it period NS, which is a physics term used to tell how many, well, in our case, nanoseconds, it takes to do a certain sequence. In this case, how long it would take to do one update if we made 60 updates each second. So I'll set it equal to 1 billion, which is the amount of nanoseconds per second, divided over our 60 updates per second, or a target UPS. We'll continue with this method a little bit later on in the series. But for now, to end off this episode, we want to add our screen to the frame we created last episode. So I jump to the top of the class and I make sure our screen extends canvas, which we'll use later on to create a buffer and render our game. If we now jump over to our frame class, after we set the size of a content pane, we create a screen object using its constructor. I will grab our content pane like we did above and use the add method to add our screen to the content pane. We still have to start the thread we created in the beginning of this episode. So at the end of our constructor, after setting the frame visible, we start the game. There's not really anything we can test from today's episode, so I'll leave it like this. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you tomorrow. Bye!